So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series we discuss a set of 5 questions which relate to finance and economics current affairs. So if you're also preparing for competitive exams and you're looking for a medium to clear all your doubts and queries, this can be a place for you, right? So before moving to question number 1 for today, I would like to ask you guys to do the customary thing. So if you are here for the very first time and you're watching our video for the first time, then do not forget to subscribe to our channel. Subscribing to our channel can help you associate with us and can help you to take advantage of so many videos out there. And do not forget to press this bell icon, which will notify you whenever a new video comes up. After that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible, right? Okay, here is the first question for today, which says, following are some details about some investors. Which of the following do you think would not mind to invest in negative yield bonds? So, this question talks about negative yield bonds. It gives you details of some investors, right? And you have to tell that who of the following are going to invest in negative yield bonds, right? Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution for this question is option B. Option B means 1, 3 and 4. Now, first of all, before knowing about these investors, first of all, we have to understand what is the meaning of negative yield bonds. See, guys, bond, as we all know, is a type of investment, right? So, whenever you buy a bond, beforehand you do not know whether the rate is going to be positive or negative, right? Or whatever, or whether you are going to make a profit on it or loss on it, right? So, since the question gives you that these are the investors and they are going to invest in a negative yield bond. See, bonds beforehand, you cannot know that whether they are going to provide you with negative returns or positive returns on their maturity, right? But when an investor is expecting that return on this particular bond can be negative, but still they are going for that particular bond, they know, they expect it. Obviously, you cannot be certain that the return on this investment is going to be negative. But obviously, this negative yield is expected on a bond and still the investor wants to go for it. What can be the reason behind that, right? So, I hope now you understand the meaning of negative yield bonds. So, negative yield bonds, that means, simply means that the price at which investor bought that bond is less than the yield earned out of it or the total reward earned out of it, right? So, what are the rewards that an investor can get on the bond? If we assume that the investor is going to hold the bond till maturity, obviously the coupon rate, let's say there is a bond on which the coupon rate is 10% and the bond is valued rupees 100. So, at fixed intervals, in that case, the investor is going to get rupees 10. And let's say if it is a 5-year bond, then after the end of 5 years, this 100 rupee will be returned to the investor. But we cannot take these cash flows, we have to take their present value, we have to incorporate time value of money. Because what rupees 100 is worth now might not be same after 5 years, right? So, do you remember our grandparents used to tell us stories that how their first salaries used to be like 50 rupees or 100 rupees and they would manage the entire household in it. That means obviously that the purchasing power of rupee has declined. You cannot buy from rupees 100 what you used to do 20 years back, right? So that is why if you know that in coming 5 years this bond is going to give me 10 rupee per year, that doesn't actually mean 10 rupee. You have to find out the present value, right? So we are not going into calculations here. So what I want to say is that when we calculate this present value, we incorporate time value of money into our calculations, then we find out the actual return, that whether we have made a profit on a bond or on an investment or loss, right? So negative yield bond, that means the investor has made a loss, or the price at which investor bought the bond is higher than the price at which he is selling it, right? So basically he has bought the bond at high prices and he is selling the bond at low prices, right? So that is what is the meaning of negative yield, bond yield, right? Okay. So negative bond yield, when an investor receives less money at the bond maturity than the original purchase price for the bond, right? Many hedge funds and investment firms. Now we have to understand then why an investor who is expecting that the return out of the bond is going to be negative still invests into it, right? So this usually happens when the interest rate is expected to rise in future, because if interest rate is expected to rise, that means lower prices for your bonds, lower prices for your bonds, and for the investors who are going to hold the bond till maturity, it means that if inflation is high or interest rates are expected to rise in future, the purchasing power of rupee is going to be even lesser, right? Okay, so many hedge funds and investment firms that manage mutual funds must meet certain requirements, including asset allocation. But see, obviously the return on this bond is negative. That is what the investor is expecting. But still that investor is going for it. That means he is looking for some other aspects like safety. Obviously such bonds, such investments which provide you with very low rate of return, they are relatively safer because there is a risk return trade-off, right? So mutual funds, they have some limit that they have to allocate some part of their investments into safer bonds, into safer assets, no matter if they provide them with a very low or even a negative return, right? So mutual funds that are bound to invest in such bonds, they will have to invest in it, right? After that, bonds often used to pledge as collateral. So banks, when they give out loans, they need collateral. And sometimes the borrowers, they pledge their investments as collateral. They can be shares or bonds. Sometimes the banks demand that we need you to have some safe bonds as your investment so that the bank can be sure of their return. See, the return can definitely be negative, but the return is obviously fixed on a bond, right? So you know that at least this much money you are going to earn from bond, right? So that is why banks, they also find it safer and they want it as collateral. So a borrower who wants to take a loan for which the bank is demanding the bond as collateral, the safe bond, that particular borrower will have to invest in that bond. After that, some investors believe that they can still make the money even with negative yields. And how is it so? By investing into foreign currency, right? So many a times an investor who is investing into bonds of, let's say, some other country, let's say there is an Indian investor who is buying a US dollar, a US bond denominated in dollar, right? Now the yield of that bond is expected to be negative, but the investor thinks that he is going to make gain when he will convert that particular gain from dollar into rupees, right? That means, let's say dollar is expected to appreciate against Indian rupee, so he might make some loss on the investment, right? So here two things are at play: currency gain, currency change, and return on bond. So an investor can earn from these two things: the return from investment, the bond in which he is investing, and the change in currency also. Now, if the investor thinks that the currency change is going to be high and he can make a good profit here and he can compensate for bonds negative yield, then he might invest in it, right? After that, domestically, investors might expect a period of deflation. So I told you, when we are expecting inflation, we are expecting interest rates to rise, then in that case, people do not consider investment into fixed income securities as a good option, right? So in that case, if someone is expecting a deflation, or someone is expecting that the prices of goods and services are going to go down in future rather than rise, then they think that I might be fine with that loss in the investment that I'm facing, because the prices are also going to be lower, so my purchasing power might not change. So someone who expects deflation or lower prices in the future is not going to be much demotivated for investing into negative yield bonds, right? So investors might also be interested in negative yield bonds if the loss is less than what it would be in other investments. So if they think that the losses in other investments are really high, but here the loss is limited, they can control it, or they have the capacity to bear it, then they might go for it, because here the losses might be minimum or lesser as compared to other investment avenues, right? Coming back to the cases. Okay, so Mr. Jha believes in future, that in future prices are going to fall. He sees economic uncertainty due to COVID-19 as a harbinger of deflation. So Mr. Jha is expecting deflation. That is why Jha might not be discouraged to invest in such bonds, and he might invest, right? Ashutosh is thinking of buying a Harley Davidson within coming 5 years. He needs to buy an investment in which can fund a major part of his purchase. So definitely Ashutosh is not going to go for it, because he needs to have a good purchasing power. After that, Ginny and Sunny are thinking of taking a home loan, for which they need necessary investments into safe bonds to put them as collateral. So here they need a loan, and for that they need bonds. So that is why they would have to invest in bonds. After that, Mr. Shah, exporter, wants to invest in safe overseas bonds. No more. So in a country whose currency is expected to appreciate. So see, since the currency in which he wants to invest is expected to appreciate, or is expected to rise in value. That is why even if he makes a loss on bond, he is not concerned with it, because he is more concerned with the gain that he can make in the currency. And here he needs a safe bond, for which bonds can do a good job. So he might not mind in investing into negative yield bonds, or in a bond whose yield is expected to be negative, right? So the correct option is B, 1, 3 and 4, right? I hope now you are clear with this concept of negative yield bonds. Moving ahead. Okay, here is your second question for today. Okay, this question says, which one of the following is correct about the risk appetite of investors? Very simple question, 5 statements given to you. You have to select the correct option. Guys, you can pause the video and take some time to read and interpret these statements carefully, and then come up with an answer. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option C. Option C means an individual with many assets and few liabilities definitely has a high ability to take on risk. So guys, okay, these statements look like really similar, but we are going to discuss each one of them, why others are not correct and why this one is correct. Okay, just leave it for a few seconds. Let us first discuss the other ones, right? Okay, so the first statement A says, individual, so there is a person who has many assets, but that person has very few liabilities. Obviously, this tells you that that person is having a good financial position. His assets are greater than his liabilities. Has a high willingness to take on risk. So here we have to differentiate between two terms, ability and willingness. So see, willingness and ability are two different terms. Willingness means that you want to do something, right? And ability means you have the capability to do something, right? That is, okay. For example, let us take the example of Mrs. X. So Mrs. X learned driving when she was 20 years old, but she actually hates driving, right? So she is somewhat like, do you remember the Deepika Padukone movie called Piku, in which she knew how to drive but she didn't like to drive, right? So this is, you can try to understand the difference between willingness and ability. So here she has the ability to drive because she knows how to drive, she has got a driving license, so she has the ability, but since she does not like to do it, she does not have the willingness, or she does not want to do it, right? So there is difference between ability and willingness. Ability matlab ki aap kar sakte ho, aapke paas usko karne ki shamta hai, but विलिंगनेस मीन्स आपका मन है या नहीं है इन सिंपल टर्म्स, राइट? आई होप नाउ यू अंडरस्टैंड द डिफरेंस. दैट इज व्हाई ओके एन इंडिविजुअल विद मेनी एसेट्स, सो वन पर्सन हु हैज गॉट मेनी एसेट्स एंड लिमिटेड लाइबिलिटीज, has a high willingness that is not necessary. A person who is in a good financial position might not be a risk seeker. He wants to be a conservative investor. That is totally upon his or her choice, right? So willingness comes with choice, and ability means whether you can do it or not, whether you have the capability for it or not, right? So this investor has the capability but does not want to do it. So willingness is not necessary. Necessary with good financial position, but obviously ability is there. A person who has got many assets, few liabilities has the ability, right? Second statement, person with fewer assets, many liabilities has a low willingness. Not necessarily a person who is not in a very good financial position might be having a huge risk appetite, right? So match between willingness and ability is not necessary. After that, individual with many assets, few liabilities definitely has a low ability. So this statement is wrong because he has got many assets, few liabilities. So definitely he has a high ability. Individual with few assets, many liabilities has a high willingness, not necessarily. So willingness is never necessary, right? Moving ahead. So here we are talking about risk. This analysis of risk comes under the purview of risk profiling. So there is a term called risk profiling, which means charting down your risk or trying to analyze that how much is the risk appetite of investor. And obviously the financial position does play a role here, but it is not a necessary thing, there is no positive correlation between ability and willingness, right? So risk profiling means analyzing your risk appetite, how much risk you want to take and you can take, basically trying to fit a match between willingness and ability. Risk profile, evaluation of individual's willingness and ability, right? It is important for determining a proper investment asset allocation for an individual as well as for organizations. Organizations also use it to find if there is any threat to them, to their potential profit. Is there any potential risk in the market, or let's say if there is any threat in the market, they use risk analysis or risk profiling to find it. Financial advisors created. Who does it? The risk profiling work. Financial advisors create risk profile of investors by the means of questionnaires. So what is the tool to carry out risk profiling? Questionnaires. Questionnaires means it's just a compilation of many questions which the client is asked, so that the financial advisor can find out that whether they want to take much risk or they can afford to take it or not, right? Questionnaires aim to fit subjective. The word subjective risk appetite, which means which changes or which varies from person to person, risk appetite of an individual in numeric terms or any objective field. So they try to measure the risk taking ability of an investor, so that the investor does not take such high risk that he cannot afford to, or the investor should not be taking such low risk that he is not getting any returns in the market. Moving ahead. Okay. Question 3, which says dash occurs when a company purchases an asset or another company at less than net fair market value. Moving ahead to the solution. Solution says that the correct option is B. B means badwill. Badwill, I think, very simple term to understand. The opposite of goodwill is badwill. Do you remember when in a previous session we discussed about premium, that how one company buys another company at a higher price or at a price more than the market price? The difference is known as premium, and in accounting terms it is put as goodwill, right? So Badwill is negative goodwill. When one company is buying other company at a price which is lower than the market price or than the true and than the worth of the company. Because see, the buyer is also buying the bad publicity or bad image which is related to that particular company. That is why he is buying a liability. So just as goodwill is an intangible asset, badwill is an intangible liability which the buyer is buying along with the company. That is why they need to take it in account. Moving ahead. Badwill, also known as negative goodwill, companies usually below when they purchase fair market value when they are in financial distress. When any company, it is in financial distress and it wants itself to get sold in the market, then usually badwill comes into play. Opposite of goodwill, both badwill and goodwill are intangible. Reasons to companies to sell below. Why would a company agree to a deal which is buying it lesser than its worth or lesser than its fair value? When the company has financial distress or if the company is a huge debt and it just desperately wants a bigger company to buy it and pay off its debt. Or if there is a hostile takeover, in that case also sellers, sellers are uninformed, the company does not even know what is its true worth. That is why they cannot determine a particular price for their sale. Or no potential acquirer, if the company is having difficulty in buying finding an acquirer, just as the case happened with Jet Airways. So Jet, we all know that it was in financial distress. Government has been trying to find buyers for it. Even for Air India, they are trying to find buyers, right? So in that case, government has to sweeten the deal. Sometimes they have to take the liabilities so that they find a buyer for it or offer buyer some incentives in order to buy it, right? So I think quite relatable in today's times. When many companies, they are in huge financial distress and they need to be saved by bigger companies. Moving ahead. And that is why many companies are also getting into acquisitions, because they are getting some really good companies which are facing some temporary distress due to COVID at very good or beaten down prices, right? So question number 4 for today. Let's see what the question number 4 says. It says Nick's father is going to invest in a company. It's a different type of company that does not seem to perform the same activities as a traditional company. Father tells him about some details of this type of companies. So two statements given to you. It is formed to raise money through an IPO to buy another company, and it is also known as a blank check company. After that, but his dad left the name of the company for him to explore. Could you help him out? So this is a new type of company that we are going to talk about. Moving ahead to the solution. Solution says that the correct option is A, which is special purpose acquisition company, or popularly known as SPACs. Right. So as you just read in the study, in the case here, that these companies are somewhat different from traditional companies. And why is this so? This is so because they do not perform the same jobs that a normal company does. What is the job of a normal company, a traditional company? They usually manufacture a good or service, or they are in the supply chain processes. Basically, they are providing some sort of goods or either services to their clients, right, or to their customers. But these type of companies, they are not into providing they're not into such jobs, but their main purpose is to raise money. And how to raise money? Using an IPO, conducting an IPO, and then using that money which is collected by this IPO to buy another company. Basically, they are in the business of buying different other companies, usually smaller companies. They are also known as blank check companies. Now let us understand some more things about the special purpose acquisition company. So in this chart you can see some of the things. So usually what happens is there is a parent company there is a company which is the acquirer company. This acquirer company buys the target company and becomes the parent company, right? But here what is happening here is there is a special purpose company. This company is buying target company, right? And this special purpose company has raised money from different sort of investors with the help of an IPO, right? So here both of them are at benefit, both of the sides. First of all, see, why is it beneficial for this target company to sell themselves to a special purpose acquisition company rather than going for an IPO themselves, right? Because obviously, if they want to go public, if they want to sell themselves, then why not go for an IPO themselves? Why? Taking the help of an SPAC. This is because the real life IPOs, they are very difficult to conduct. So many formalities associated with it, and there is a risk if that IPO is going to be successful or not, whether public is going to accept the shares or is it going to be oversubscribed, undersubscribed. Apart from that, so many regulatory formalities, right? But in this case, their one job or their one effort is to find a good company that can help them, because see, this company is already associated with so many investors, right? So the target company need not find many investors or might not need not persuade public that please buy our shares, right? They just need to convince one seller, that is SPAC. And these investors who are putting their money into SPAC, they don't even know that what they are putting their money into, because when the company is formed and after that, what kind of companies will it acquire? These investors, they do not know, or they are not sure of it, right? So if you invest into Tata Motors, you know you are investing into automobile, or if you invest into some pharma company, you know that you are investing into that particular sector. But not here, because these investors do not know that which is going to be the target company, which sector is it going to belong to, right? So the process of an SPAC. So this process of SPAC has been really popular recently, and it's been seen in the renewable energy sector, right? Where many firms who work into the sector of creating clean fuel, they are getting their buyers or they are getting investors through this process of SPAC, right? Okay, special purpose acquisition companies. Company with no commercial operations, right? Formed strictly to raise capital through an IPO for the purpose of acquisition. Generally formed by the investors. Who forms this type of company? Usually the big investors, they do it. They can be some sponsors, they can be promoters of other companies who have expertise in a particular industry or business sector with the intention of pursuing deals in that area. Usually, the investors, they come from some sort of similar background, they have expertise in one particular field. In creating an SPAC, founders sometimes have at least one acquisition target in mind, but they do not identify the target. So when an SPAC is being created, they have some idea that okay, we'll acquire this company, we'll acquire this company from this particular sector, but it is not defined formally, or it is not certain, it is not confirmed, right? So they do not identify the target to avoid extensive disclosures during the IPO process, right? And there are many restrictions. The money that they are using through raising through IPOs, they have to use it for any acquisition only. They cannot use it for any other purpose. And they have a certain time limit. Usually they have 2 years to make that acquisition, or if they are unable to do so, then the SPAC should have returned the money back to investors. Money SPAC receives in an IPO, it is placed in an interest-bearing trust account. So then the money that they collect, see, the process is somewhat like SPAC is formed, it goes for an IPO, raises money and then acquires the company. So the money that they beforehand raised through an IPO, it is put into an account which provides them with some sort of interest, and this interest is usually used for the working capital or for fulfilling the basic expenses of the SPAC. Funds cannot be dispersed except to complete an acquisition or to return the money to investors if SPAC is liquidated or they are unable to make the acquisition. SPAC generally has 2 years or they should face liquidation. After an acquisition, SPAC is listed on one of the major stock exchanges. So once they are successful in making the acquisition, they are listed onto stock exchanges, right? So I hope the concept of SPAC is clear to you. Moving ahead to the last question for today. Here is the last question, which says, following are the few statements about different types of renewable energy certificates. Select the correct option in this regard. And the answer to this question is option E. So option E means all are correct. So all, just a second. Okay. So all are correct. Now first of all, we have to understand the meaning of RECs or renewable energy certificates. Okay. So guys, that we all know that how the traditional sources of resource energy, producing energy, have been polluting the planet and we are facing many problems of it. So obviously we have to find some alternatives and we need to promote them, right? So we need to promote some renewable energy sources like solar energy and wind energy, right? Now how to incorporate finance into this? See, RECs is an instrument which tells you that you are owner of 1 megawatt of energy. So if you have 1 REC, that means you are having 1 megawatt of energy, right? And the quantity of energy that that a particular person holds, he is the owner, he or she is the owner of that sort of energy. Now talking about governments, obviously the electricity that we use in our homes, that has to come from somewhere, and usually it is the responsibility of governments and many a time joint venture between public and private sector that they maintain that public should receive basic electricity facilities, right? So see, electricity distribution companies, they buy power from power generators. So just the entity producing power is different from the entity distributing power. So these distributors, when they buy energy or they buy renewable power from the generator, in return they get REC, that is renewable energy certificates, that proves that they are owner or they are buying this amount of, so the amount of RECs they get, that proves that they are buying that amount of renewable energy, right? So many states, they require power utilities to purchase or generate renewable solar power. These requirements are called solar carve-outs, right? So many states, they require their companies that they should buy some amount, like the total capacity that they are buying or the power they are buying, some part of it shall be coming from the renewable sources. So if it comes from solar power, it is known as solar carve-outs. Similarly, many states have a renewable portfolio standard that we use this percentage of energy which is coming from the renewable sources, and the companies who are buying this power, they have to take care that they buy some amount which has been pre-decided. They have to buy that particular amount of power from renewable energy, right? So just as we define for banks that you have to put that much of your money into liquid assets, here is the similar case that companies are being told that okay, if you are buying power, this much of power should be bought from renewable sources, right? So this particular standard is known as renewable portfolio standard, and to fulfill this, companies have to get RECs from the generators which prove their ownership of that renewable power, right? So which requires power services to create a certain amount of renewable power that increases every year, right? So here is the developer producing the power, getting money from the institution buying it and providing REC in return, right? And also providing a utility to the public, right? And now these RECs, they can be traded on stock exchanges, like different commodities like shares or stocks, just as we trade different type of commodities like agricultural commodities or oil or wheat, whatever is traded on stock exchange, RECs helps investors, RECs help their developers, or REC enables investors to trade in power, right? So if there is any opportunity for arbitrage, the price of power in market one is less or high. Basically, if there are two different prices for power in two different markets, then there is obviously an opportunity for arbitrage. You can buy from where the price is less and sell it to the highly priced market, right? So RECs provide that mechanism, which can easily be traded on stock exchanges, right? So the amount of RECs that are being traded, that tells you about, that gives you an indication of renewable energy that is being used. So it acts as an accounting or tracking mechanism for renewable energy, right? And it has different names like green tag, tradable, renewable certificates, etc. So the unused power created from a renewable energy source will receive a credit that can eventually be sold for a profit. Basically, the owners, whoever is owning this electricity, they can get REC and they can prove that they are the owners of electricity, right? So, and then trade these RECs on the stock exchanges for a profit. So that is why all three statements are correct. So REC swap consists of trading RECs to profit, just as I told you that they can make profit and certify that bearer has 1 megawatt of energy. Generator of renewable energy provides RECs to the buyer of power, because then the buyer is becoming the owner, right? So I hope now you are clear with this concept of renewable energy certificates. You can easily find it in newspapers that it is being traded on the stock exchange. Separate energy exchanges are there, right? So this is REC. These were the 5 questions for today, guys. This is it, and I hope you found this session beneficial. Before ending this session, I would like to take a few doubts. Okay, this was one thing which was asked by Durlabh, which is plurilateralism. When we discussed multilateralism, he asked the difference between both the terms. So Durlabh, I've been trying to find it, but I've been not able to find much about it. But what I have understood till now is, see, multilateralism refers to institutions like the activities of institutions like World Bank, IMF, they say that they work for the collective good of all the countries. Whereas plurilateralism, it refers to group of countries who have arisen against of these institutions, these institutions, or they are trying to fulfill the needs of those particular countries in that group, right? So basically, multilateralism tries to include everyone, whereas plurilateralism tries to benefit the certain members who are part of the group, right? So this is, if I'll find something else, I'll try to share it with you. Okay, Pooja was asking that when we discussed that how companies which are into social investing, or companies who are looking that who are taking care of what their actions are having impact on environment, they are seeing an increase in preference among investors. So Pooja was asking that companies like ITC who produce tobacco, how sustainable it is for them or for an investor to invest into these companies. See, such big companies like ITC, they are not going to go unsustainable, at least not in the near future, because no matter how much there is, not everyone has a moral compass, right? If we talk about ESG investing, not every investor wants to invest into ESG companies, right? Many of them would want profit, and they see how people are into alcohol, people are into smoking, they might want to invest in such company, right? So not everyone has a moral compass, not every investor wants to invest on this behalf. So that is why these companies are not going to be unsustainable, at least not such big companies like ITC, right? So guys, this is it for today. I'll see you in the next session, and thank you for being here. Take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and I'll meet you in the next session. Goodbye.